In respect to those who have arrived on time, I suggest to start and probably to show up. Let's start and finish on time. So it's my great pleasure to lead this seminar, one of our political science and international affairs department regular seminars. And the topic of today's seminar is local government reforms in Europe in the 21st century. And on that occasion, we are happy to host a great colleague and a friend, Dr. Pavel Svanevich from the University of Warsaw. Pavel Svanevich is head of the Department of Local Development and Policy at the Faculty of Geography and Regional Studies. Professor Svanevich is not a newcomer to Armenia. He's been here back in 2017 and 2016. And he even had another lecture here in our premises. In addition, he was consulting different projects in Armenia, and not only in Armenia, but also in Georgia and elsewhere around Central and Eastern Europe. The range of the issues that we are going to address today is really pretty broad. And the reason is that the scope of administrative territorial administrative reform in Europe is now taking a large scale. Over 20 countries has undergone through that reform, and as we were just few minutes before talking in Dr. Mateo Sanz's office, the latest examples are Estonia, Armenia, Norway, Ukraine, and others. So there's a lot to learn, a lot to share, and definitely there's a lot to study and to kind of try to systematize. So that's what Professor Svanevich has been doing for a number of years, for probably a couple of decades, and he is the author of a number of publications, and just to mention the recent ones is the 2019 publication Patterns of Local Autonomy, published by Patrick Macmillan, Submunicipal Governance in Europe, Decentralization Beyond the Municipal Tier, published in London, Intermunicipal Cooperation in Europe, Institutions and Governance, 2018, and so forth. So, without further ado, I want to just provide the floor to Professor Svanevich, and the slides are on the screen. Please, for the students. This is very important.
Well, actually, I'm accustomed to lecture while standing, but I'm not sure. Do I need to use a microphone?
Yes.
Okay, so it's better if I sit than I
sit. There's a mic here.
You can do it.
Okay, let's. Okay, so, well, good afternoon. I'm very glad that I have an occasion to talk to you. And indeed, the topic which we've discussed with Dr. Artur Drampian is very wide. So I need to be very superficial sometimes, and I need to concentrate on some issues only. Because when we think about local government reforms, we may think about many very different types of reforms. It's not a scientific classification of reforms, but when you think about what you mean by local government reforms, And even if we limit just to 21st century, two decades of 21st century, we realize how vibrant for local governments in Europe have been these two decades. Well, there are some countries in which you had decentralization reforms. By decentralization reforms, I mean, in this case, mostly passing new functions, extending number of functions local governments are responsible for. Or in some other countries, you have the opposite process of re-centralization, when certain functions which were decentralized before were taken back by government administration. Well, electoral reforms. In some countries, you had reforms of electoral law. I will give some examples later on. Important trace on a dimension of reforms is related to service delivery reforms. Until, it's difficult to be very precise, but until about 20, 15 even years ago, the dominant way of thinking about service delivery was related to new public management concepts. But there has been increasingly, this concept has been increasingly criticized. So we are in a sort of a chaotic post-new public management era, and service delivery reforms might be seen through that perspective. Finally, a very important type of local government reforms is related to territorial reforms, mostly to amalgamation or merger of local governments, the reform which you know also from Armenia, which has also very different faces. And actually, my main focus will be on this last part. But I will go briefly first through first three types of reforms as well. So let me start with decentralization reform. Arthur just mentioned one of my most recent publications, a book where I am one of seven authors about patterns of local autonomy in Europe. It was a fascinating project, in which we tried to measure, to develop joint methodology to measure autonomy of municipal governments in finally 39 European countries. And also we tried to do it like year by year between 1990 and 2014. To see not only the most current picture, but to see also the dynamics. So here on this picture, you have, and this is based on an index of several variables related to policy scope, to policy discretion regarding different functions, to financial autonomy, but also to constitutional protection, legal protection, supervision of local governments, a complex index. And here is the final result for the most recent moment we covered by our research for 2014. And you see the huge variation. Unfortunately, Armenia is not on this picture. Armenia was not part of this project. But very far to the right part, you may see Georgia, third from the right, which is one country of one of the lowest level of local autonomy in Europe. And I would guess that Armenia would be somewhere in the similar range, somewhere close to Georgia. On the opposite side, we have Switzerland and Nordic countries mostly. Finland, Sweden, Iceland, Denmark, Anyway, that is an interesting, I believe, a picture of a variation of local autonomy within Europe. But since we are talking about reforms, not the level itself is important, but the changes. And since the topic of my lecture is local government reforms in 21st century, I compared the indices in for 2000 and 2014. And I've selected here on this picture countries in which the change was the most visible, where the index was changing in the fastest way. On the left part of the slide, you have countries of Central and Eastern Europe, and on the right part, Western Europe. And I made this division to show that most, well, first of all, that 21st century so far has been era of decentralization. In most of the cases here, the bar for 2014 is higher than for 2000, which means that the level of financial, not financial, general level of local autonomy has increased during these 15 years. And it mostly happened in Central and Eastern Europe, which is easy to explain because starting point was a very low level of local autonomy. So in Macedonia, Albania, Serbia, Croatia, you have a visible increase of local autonomy because the starting point was very, very low. In Western Europe, the only similar case, in fact, is Italy. Decentralization reform has increased level of municipal autonomy in 21st century. But you may also see the opposite trends. The most spectacular is Hungary. Hungary, which until 2011 was one of two countries, apart of Poland, of Central and Eastern Europe with the strongest local governments. But quite recent reforms introduced by Orban government has taken most of this strength, and you can see the dramatic drop of level of local autonomy in Hungary. There are also some other examples of a drops of, not that dramatic as in Hungary, of drops in local autonomy index, mostly after the 2008 crisis. In several countries after 2008, well, the situation was uncertain. One of the actions for uncertain situation was to limit level of local autonomy, to control local governments, especially in terms of finance and especially in borrowing. So that was the most common change, limiting power of local governments to borrow money, limiting borrowing autonomy. Spain and Estonia are the two countries on this picture which represent this trend of a drop of local autonomy, and it happened mostly after 2008, after the beginning of the crisis. Another type of reforms which was relatively often in Europe in 21st century, it's related to electoral reforms and especially direct election of mayors. So if you go back 25 years ago, direct election of mayors by all residents of municipality, it was a very rare solution in Europe. Now when you look at Europe, it is in more than half of the country. There are still countries or even regions which do not want direct elections. Scandinavia. None of Scandinavian countries has direct elections. Mayor is relatively weak and mayor is appointed by the council. But in more than half of the countries, we have now direct election of mayors. It's not my specific topic today, so I will not discuss in depth the reasons and consequences, but I just want to show you that only within Central and Eastern Europe there are some countries which has undergone this reform in 21st century. Poland in 2002, Croatia in 2009, Lithuania in 2016, Georgia is a bit more complicated issue because during the last 20 years or so they were changing this back and forward a couple of times. But anyway, that was another type of reform, but also other, well, it is not the only type of electoral reforms. Poland is an example of some other types of reforms, like, for example, introduction of single-member districts, so the electoral law in which councillors are elected in a single district, a majoritarian system, like typical, well, the system which is best known from election of House of Commons in United Kingdom. Or the recent reform in Poland, limiting number of terms of office for mayors. I'm not fan of this reform, but it's a separate story. Anyway, the new law is that you can be mayor for two subsequent terms, 5 years each, and then you cannot candidate again. So that is another example of electoral reforms. The third type of reforms is related to service delivery reforms. And let me start with a small glimpse of a history of how provision of local public services in Europe has looked like across contemporary history. So the first phase was end of 19, beginning of 20th century, first decades of 20th century. Local governments were responsible for a relatively narrow set of functions, for functions which someone called, I like this term, metabolic function of cities. Water provision, sewage, waste collection, street cleaning, street lighting, public transportation, but not so much for social services. And in that phase, local governments were responsible and they were delivering. I mean, being responsible and delivering service meant the same. It was the same. Second phase, especially in Western Europe, but to some extent also in Soviet bloc, after Second World War, in 50s, 60s, 70s, development of local welfare state. So, especially broadening role of local governments in social services, in provision of preschool, school education, sometimes healthcare, social protection. Scandinavia has gone the most far in that direction, but it was also a case of other countries. And then, end of 70s, beginning of 80s, was a moment of sort of disappointment with the welfare state concept. And 80s and especially 1990s, the last decade of previous century, was a moment of questioning of the role of public sector and the dominant way of thinking about provision of local public services was a new public management. Not going into details, the closest summary of this approach would be that public sector is ineffective. So as far as possible, we should use private sector provision. We should introduce market mechanism, competition. Even if we cannot privatize, we should still look for a way to introduce a competition. And public administration should adjust its management forms to follow private companies, to use management techniques known from private companies. So that was 1990s, beginning of 21st century. But then you had a more and more widespread criticism, especially after the 2008 crisis, but even before. So if you look at ideologies driving thinking about public service provision, look at pendulum. So you had the pendulum in the direction of private sector and neoliberal approach, and then the pendulum moved to another extreme of criticizing market, criticizing competition, and criticizing neoliberal approach. So I will come back in a moment and to the current stage. So first, line of criticism was that the impact of new public management on practical behavior of local administration was overestimated. And second, that consequences of marketization, privatization were different from promised. Reduction of costs, which was promised, was doubtful or short term. In a long term, especially in quasi-monopoly situations, it was doubtful. And also indication of negative consequences of management by performance indicators, especially in social services, that providers of services behave in a way which is pro-ranking, not pro-social. So a direct headmaster of school is not so much concerned with the quality of education. He's concerned with the position of his school in different rankings. And it's not quite the same, regardless how much we try to introduce a system of performance which would reflect the real quality of services. Being driven by ranking, by performance indicators is not exactly the same as being driven by the quality of services. So this is another stream of criticism. And also, part of rhetoric of new public management was that city should be like a company. City as a firm, city as a company. City should behave like a company. Well, there is also a normative rejection. No, we don't think city should behave like a company. Company has different set of goals. City should have more social goals than business-oriented goals. So what is the current situation? Well, 3 years ago, in another book which Arthur quoted in the introduction, we described this. We made a survey of opinion of mayors in 29 European countries on many, many different issues. But one of the issues we were asking mayors was, what do they think about the way different services should be provided? And in particular, I picked up one part of this topic. Do you think that local government needs more outsourcing, or do you think that local government should limit outsourcing? Okay, opinions were very much divided, but it's even more funny that arguments of proponents and opponents are the same. So, supporters of outsourcing said 24% said, if we have more outsourcing, we would lower costs. But 18% of males said, no, if we reduce outsourcing, we would lower costs. And if you look at some other arguments, well, the opinions are very much split. Another illustration. Helmut Bormann and Gerard Marcoux formulated the hypothesis that the next phase after a new public management, they call it remunicipalization or recommunalization. It means the situation in which services which were privatized before are now being re-municipalized again. And they provide in their book examples from Italy, from France, from Germany. For example, French cities which usually privatized water provision. But recently, some of the cities decided not to extend concession for private companies. Or some waste management companies in Germany, bought back by local governments. So they formulate this hypothesis. But what is clear is that they are able to provide examples of the municipalization, but it's not a dominant threat. And there is no dominant threat. So if you ask what is the dominant threat, the answer is there is no dominant threat. And an illustration of this lack of dominant trend is here. We asked males in these 20-something countries about preferred form of service delivery in different services. Here you have waste management, just one example. Red color means what proportion of males said it should be public. Enormous variation. Poland and Denmark on the one extreme, Croatia and Hungary on another extreme, but doesn't matter, I'm not going into explanation why particular countries here or there. What I wanted to say, there is enormous variation. And if you take another service, there would be similar variation, maybe order of countries might be different, but still enormous variation. So at the moment we are in an era where there is no dominant tendency, no dominant trend of local service delivery. And finally, for the second half of my lecture, I want to concentrate on territorial reforms. And the starting point has to be to note that if you look at the territorial organization of European countries, there is enormous variation. And instead of giving you a long table with figures, I decided to pick up two extreme countries. You have municipal organization of France on the left side and of England on the right side of a picture. France has around 35,000 of communes. 80% of them is smaller than 1,000 population. In England, the smallest local government has about 25,000. So would be huge, one of the largest in France. Mean is even larger now than 150,000. It's about 170,000 at the moment. So I remember in late 1990s, I was a director of British Local Fund Project in Poland for local governments. And I remember a nice consultant who came from England and said, look, I have a tool, it's very useful for small local governments. And I looked at this and I said, well, it was pretty complicated. But then I thought and I said, what do you mean by small local government? And he said, well, 80,000. It's, yeah, 80,000, 60,000, it's very small local government. Okay, so you have a different meaning of what is small, what is large. So, okay, you may ask, why? Why there are so such enormous differences? And why France has not changed its local government territorial system, in spite it looks very strange. And one of the reasons is that territorial reforms, politically speaking, are among the most politically difficult reforms related to local governments. They always meet with resistance. Lord Paddison, a Scottish geographer, wrote once in this context that Turkey rarely vote for Christmas. That's an English saying, of course. Christmas are, turkeys are usually eaten for Christmas in England. Mayor, okay, it may happen that mayor would support the territorial reform if he or she expects to stay as a mayor of a larger local government. But most of them would lose their posts. Many councillors would lose their posts. So this is a very cynical but important explanation why there would be a strong resistance. But apart of this cynical political sort of rational choice, there is also true that local government has symbolic meaning for the local community. And local communities would oppose the change because it's important for their self-identity. There are also some rational fears which make opposition, which produce opposition to the reform. People may be afraid of marginalization of interests. If we merge with a larger local government, we may think, well, the town hall would forget about us. We are far away, they would not invest here. We will be forgotten. There would be more difficult physical access to some services, especially to administrative services. There might be a fear of territorial conflicts. If we create one big local government consisting of different parts, there might be conflicts between them, which might sort of make impossible smooth operation of local governments. And usually, if you want to introduce, that's a European experience, if you want to introduce territorial reform, usually there is a relatively short period when it is politically possible. That's an expression of window of political opportunity. This window opens in some circumstances, but it usually closes quite often. Paul-Erik Mauritsen, describing Danish territorial reform of 2007, used a sort of a military analogy. He said, the war has to be won before the natural enemies can mobilize themselves to block the reform. Every territorial reform has natural enemies. And if you give them enough time, they would mobilize and block the reform. So that it might be, it has to be introduced quickly. If you work on preparation too long, then you are lost. You cannot implement this reform at all. Jon Askim and Jan Erling Clausen, two Norwegians, recently published a paper trying to explain why reform happens in some circumstances, but why they don't happen, territorial reforms, in some other circumstances. They built a model based on a very nice theoretical discussion in which they saw three major facilitating factors. One is fiscal stress. If local governments are under fiscal stress, you are looking for cutting costs. And often, territorial reform is seen as a method to cut costs. So So it might be a direct reason. Second, urbanization. People moving to the urban centers, in two ways it may influence territorial reforms. One is that cities grow, so you have urban sprawl, the city is sprawling around its old boundaries, and sometimes one of the methods of dealing with this is to extend city limits. But this movement to urban centers means also that in a province there is a strong depopulation. I will refer a bit later on to the most extreme example, concrete example, which I remember. In Albania, one local government, there were two national censuses. In 2001, this community had 3,000 population. Okay, not big, but you can think about local government of this size. In 2011, just 10 years later, population of this community was 300. So 90% the population sort of evaporated during one decade. In such a situation, there is an argument for some change of territorial organization in this provincial part. The third is decentralization, functional decentralization. If you plan to pass new functions, or if you conclude that at the moment some local governments are not able to cope with some delivery of some functions, it may also support territorial reform. Then they added some filtering factors which also may influence the fact of the reform. What is size of local governments? If they were already big, then the likelihood of the reform is lower. What has been history of territorial reforms? And what is the political culture? For example, consensual cultures might behave differently than majoritarian political cultures. But also, what is the system of local government legal protection? In some systems, it's impossible to introduce the territorial change against the will of a local council. So, and actually, they model not perfectly, but they show that it might be applied as a prediction of actual reforms quite nicely. But anyway, let me tell you that if you look just to the period after 2000, there is a huge number of European countries which has undergone territorial amalgamation reforms. Macedonia, Georgia, Latvia, Albania, Estonia, Denmark, Greece, Ireland, all of these countries have had territorial reforms after 2000. But it's not the end. Also, in some countries which are federal states, and territorial reform depends not on a federal government but on individual lands in Germany or cantons in Switzerland, you had at least 5 reforms in Germany, in one of Austrian Länder, and in 3 cantons. Still not the end, because there are some countries in which it's difficult to indicate one moment of the reform, but it is like step by step, year by year, some of local governments merge. So if you compare 2000 and 2017, it's a totally different picture. England, Finland, Netherlands, Iceland are good examples of this. And it's not, still not the end, because there are few countries with ongoing reforms, including Armenia. In some part, in some parts, you've already had this reform, but not in every. Ukraine and Norway are two other countries in which the reform is going on, and it's not very easy to say what would be the final result, plus some regional reforms. So a huge revival of territorial reforms. If you look at total number of municipalities in 40 European countries, including Armenia this time, well, from 1990 to 2004, it increased. So, which shows that not only territorial merger, but something else has happened. But between 2004 and 2014, number of local governments decreased by more than a dozen thousands. About 14,000 local governments decreased. In 2018, my estimation is that it would be about, I do not have precise data yet, but it would be even lower, about just over 100,000 municipal governments. So it shows how many reforms. But in spite of these several reforms, there are still cases of extremely small municipalities in Europe. Well, the most funny perhaps are countries which have municipalities with no residents. So it might be a village which has no permanent residents, maybe some summer houses, but it still exists on the map of administrative division. It happens, well, it might be also some from the military sites or different reasons, but there are some strange examples like this of municipalities with no residents. Okay, but also you have even a longer list of countries which have cases of extremely small municipalities. By extremely small, I consider those who have less than 50, not 50,000, just 50, less than 50 residents. And Armenia is on this list, Tyrol, Austria, Hungary, Iceland, Italy, Slovakia, Spain, several cantons of Switzerland, and five cantons of Switzerland. So still, in spite of this territorial amalgamation reforms, they do exist. And finally, I mentioned that not only mergers, it's not the only type of territorial reforms. When you look at some countries, especially of Eastern and Central Europe, you had many divorces of municipalities. Romania and Ukraine are the most spectacular. In Romania over 200, but also in Slovenia, Slovakia, Czech Republic, Hungary, or less numerous cases in Poland, Lithuania, Bulgaria. So merger of local governments is a dominant form of territorial reform, but not the main, not the only one. Okay, why the territorial merger reforms happen? So what are expectations of reformers? What are promises of the reformers? Well, I think that they might be classified into five groups. Economy of scale is a first promise. That would be cheaper. If we amalgamate, we will enjoy scale benefits. It would be unit cost of service delivery would be cheaper. Second promise is that we may decentralize more functions. Capacity of local governments to deliver wide scope of functions would be larger. Third, related to the second, but separate, you may expect higher qualifications of administrative staff in larger local governments. Why? First of all, because if you have larger local administration, you may specialize. You may get a specialized training. In a very small local government, you have just few clerks, few employees. So they cannot specialize in one thing. They need to do many things at the same time, so their qualifications are lower. And if so, we may expect higher quality of local services after we introduce merger of local governments. And finally, we may also expect more coherent, especially spatial planning, but also local economic development policies. So these are promises. And well, most of arguments against amalgamation are related to local democracy, saying that, well, the distance from the citizen to mayor to councillor would be larger, with several negative consequences. I do not have time to go into details, but also proponents of the reform, they have arguments that they may help local democracy by merging local governments, because in larger local governments would be higher electoral competition, and competition is crucial for democracy. And second, because if we give more functions to local governments, which is possible when we have larger local governments, citizens would have more reasons to be interested in local government operation. But, okay, so these are the promises. The crucial question is whether it's true, whether it really happens. And for academic, for the researcher, another methodological question is how to measure it, how to check it, whether it's true or not. Okay, and I can give you a very simple example of checking. In 2013 or 14, Ministry of Public Administration in Poland released a report. By the way, Vice Minister at the moment was my former student, I was supervisor of her MA dissertation, in which there was this picture. Per capita spending of municipal governments in different size cohorts, showing that both total expenditures and current expenditures per capita are higher in small local governments than in big local governments. So the conclusion was, it means that we should think, not immediately, there is no plan, we should think about territorial reform in Poland, especially local governments below 5,000 residents. Perhaps it would be worth to think about merging them, because they are more expensive. They need more money to operate. Sounds convincing? Well, 15 years ago, probably I would say yes. But now I say no. It's wrong. It's totally false conclusion. Because we don't know if they spend more money because they are smaller, or do they spend more money due to some other reasons? What might be other reasons? Just I can give you some examples. Maybe because small local governments are usually more sparsely populated. And delivery of services for a sparsely populated area is more expensive. If you merge three municipalities sparsely populated, you will still have big municipality which is sparsely populated. There are also several reasons in accounting system which may explain this. For example, in larger cities, it is often that city organizes a company, and then spending of a company is not in the budget. So the same service might be in the budget or might not be in the budget. It's very difficult to compare. We spent 2 years trying to take into account all of these factors and to correct the picture. And we came to the conclusion, no, it's impossible. It's a dead end street. We will never get an answer using this method. Another example. I was working in Albania a few years ago, And one of the arguments for territorial reform was that small local governments are not able to deliver some services. Let's take example of waste collection. Small local governments do not collect waste collection fee. It means they do not organize waste collection at all. So the conclusion of a local, of central government was, we need to merge them, we need to liquidate them as separate entities. Large local governments would deal better with the waste collection. Well, using a very simple regression model, it's very simplistic one, you realize that the most important explanatory variable is population density, not size itself. They have problems with organization of this service much more because of they are sparsely populated than because they are just small. So, well, it does not mean that Albania didn't need territorial reform. There is a demographic argument which I mentioned before. All on this map here, only red local governments are those which increased population from 2001 to 2011. All green color is related to depopulating areas, and in some cases very dramatic. Well, in 2001 there were just 12 local governments having less than 1,000. In 2011, 37. There were 48 local governments which lost over half of their population within just a decade. So demography itself was a strong argument to think about new territorial arrangements. Well, because, well, even if we take one example, what is the impact of size on unit cost? It's not very easy to answer. Because, first, you have different organizational arrangements in different local governments. You have different quality of the service. How to measure quality? Also, there are some other factors which influence the differences. Population density, peripheral location, natural environment. Well, for example, location in the mountains. If you have a road in the mountains, you need much more to remove snow in the winter than in a lowland where there is no snow, actually. So there are different factors which should be taken into account. It all makes this extremely complicated. I realize that I should finish quite soon, so I will go quite fast to a major conclusions. But I want to show you that, well, we've made analysis of different studies in international journals. First, we discovered that it's increasingly a topic which is increasingly popular. At the end of 20th century, we found only single papers in international journals. In the last 4 years, 2015 to 2018, we found over 100 articles in international journals on territorial reforms, both consequences and processes. So this is increasingly in the topic which is increasingly popular. Well, in many different countries, well, Japan, Canada, US, and Nordic countries are probably the best research in this respect. But anyway, we made analysis of some of impacts. And there are now a couple of slides which show results of this research in different countries. But my main conclusion, my main observation is that it differs. I mean, there are some cases where the promises of reformers are being met, but even if you take administrative spending, a very thorough, I will not go now into methodological issues how to measure this, but it's done, we took into account only sufficiently sophisticated methodologically papers. Results are different. Usually the result is that you have saving on the administrative costs in case of mergers, amalgamation costs, but not always. And if you go to other impact on other elements of a budget or on some non-budget parameters, also you have diversified results. So there is one thing in which most of scholars agree, the last years before the merger are very dangerous from the point of view of free riding or common pool. Let me try to explain this in a very simple form. If I go to the restaurant with Arthur and with you tonight, and we agree before we go that we share the bill, I may think, okay, I will drink an I will take an expensive bottle of wine because I will pay just one third of the bill. I will share a bill with them. And local governments before amalgamation behave in a similar way. I am in a small village which I know that it will disappear as a separate local government unit within 2 years. So let's have a party. Buy drinks, buy food. Well, we don't know what happens after we are merged.
Expensive cars.
Expensive, well, even investments, you know, we don't know if they take care of our village after merger. Now there is a last moment. Okay, we go to the bank and we borrow money. How we pay? It's not our problem. Will be part of a larger local government, and especially if the size difference is big. If a small local government is going to be merged with much larger, well, we may enjoy very nice party because for this large local government they would pay for this, they wouldn't notice. So in terms of debt, cash reserves, current spending, total spending, investment spending, there is a visible effect of overspending or overborrowing during the last moment before merger. There is one exception in all known research, which is one Polish case. I have explanation of the Polish case, but I have no time now to explain how it happened. Anyway, summing up. There is no doubt that amalgamation reforms have some positive effects. And most probably saving of administrative costs is one of them. But these effects are not as strong or not as common and as most of proponents of the reforms suggest. And usually they take it as for granted. Of course, when we do amalgamation, there would be this and this and this positive effect. Well, thorough research suggests it's not automatic. It may happen, but it might also not happen. It's not that obvious. It even happens that they have negative economic impacts. And they clearly cause transitional costs, including this free riding or common pool effect, which I was just trying to explain. Also, most of researchers suggest that there is a negative effect on local democracy. Not always again, but in most of studies, negative effect on local democracy in terms of interest in local elections, in terms of trust to local governments, in terms of satisfaction. The only positive effect is increased competition in election. So just to finish, I think just two more slides. So if territorial reforms are so difficult, if territorial reforms bring results which are not that certain as proponents of reforms suggest, perhaps intermunicipal cooperation is a viable alternative for amalgamation reforms. Well, there is a very nice article in a book edited in 2010 by Robert Herzog, who demonstrates, who tries to convince us that this is a case of France. Instead of merging these very small local governments, there is a huge infrastructure of intermunicipal cooperation, whether it's voluntary, I have doubts. Incentives for this cooperation are that strong that you should not call it still voluntary. I mean, well, it's often not to reject quite often. And several other countries in which there are very small local governments, Czech Republic, Hungary, Slovakia, Slovenia, Spain, use the same line of arguments. They say, well, we don't need amalgamation because we may arrange this through intermunicipal cooperation. But there are problems with this alternative. Well, it requires supportive legal framework, okay, can be done. Let's see. Well, there is usually a problem of democratic legitimacy of IMC structures. Those people who decide in intermunicipal unions, communities, they are not directly elected, and the democratic, if we think about local government not only as a tool to provide services, but also as a democratic institution, then we have a problem. Third, and most important, I think, that to arrange intermunicipal cooperation, you also need a minimal administrative capacity to enter all of these agreements, to control them, to monitor them. And as recent results from Spain or from Czech Republic show, the smallest local governments do not have this capacity. And opposite to what you might expect, those smallest local governments are the least often involved in intermunicipal cooperation, not the most often, as you might expect, because they lack scale benefits, so they should enter cooperation. No, they don't, because they don't have capacity to do it. And also you need cooperation culture. Trust, this is the factor which is very scale factor in many of countries of Eastern Europe. People in general do not trust each other, do not trust government, but also the mayor does not trust another mayor, so in these circumstances intermunicipal cooperation is difficult. My final conclusion is, sorry, but there are no ideal solutions. And academics who are interested in local governments and in intermunicipal cooperation and in territorial reforms, they still have a lot of work ahead, which is in a way optimist. A conclusion, because it means I will have occupation probably until I retire. We still don't know many things. We still need more research and to find more sophisticated answers, which might be more dependent on particular environment of particular place. And that is probably my final conclusion. Thank you very much.
much, Pavel, for giving this overview of the reforms in, on such a large scale that we actually witnessed that the pendulum of reforms was moving back and forth, and there's no doubt that we'll, in years and decades to come, we'll see probably more development in this area. But what is really important for us here in Armenia is that we entered into this machine, we entered into this reform, and we really need to know what are the lessons to learn from other countries and what could be our expectations. So with this, we still have some time. I would like to open the floor for questions. Please, if you have any questions, if you can introduce yourself and then ask a question. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Spanetsky. Dziękuję bardzo for a very interesting lecture. By the way, I had pleasure to study in your city in Warsaw for a year. My question is about the book which I read, about the ideas in the book which I read quite a short time ago, written by the richest monarch of Europe, Hans Adam II of Liechtenstein, where he speaks about local communities and local community reforms, actually bringing forward very bold ideas regarding the right of self-determination of local communities. So in your slide about the local community index, Liechtenstein would be probably in the westernmost point in view of Switzerland, because there the small local communities have the right of independence, and they can freely join Austria to or to Switzerland if they vote for it. I'd like to ask, is there any point, is there any red line after which the empowerment of local community is fraught with disintegration of the state? First question, and if I may, I'll ask about the second question also. So the prince is a proponent of very small, ultra-minimum government limited to home and justice and home affairs, foreign policy and education, and all the other tasks he wants to be delegated to the local communities, meaning all the direct taxation, the power to that of direct taxation, and all other tasks that are currently the obligation of the central government. I'd like to know your opinion regarding these bold ideas as well. Thank you.
Can we collect?
Yes,
she is.
Then we can collect a couple of questions.
Paul, I'm Martin Senna. I'm with the Questions. First, regarding the autonomy index. So, in many cases, we often have sub-national governments. So, I want to know, do the index consider the two types of sub-national government? And if in one country, for example, the other regional government, we have elected, so they probably have more autonomy than the small ones in the second term. And do this factor of having good health affect more in autonomy? And the second point is that the last one you mentioned, too small, is not too very good. And I want to know your opinion, is Armenia local government is too small, still too small, and we can be committed to our small communities, because in my opinion, our consolidated community is not too big, it's just 20,000.
Maybe you can take those questions. Okay. Well, first of all, well, Liechtenstein, I don't have time now, but Liechtenstein was part of study, so I could find the index for Liechtenstein. It was not on a level of Switzerland, but it was in this rather high, but well, I did not include, to make this picture a bit simpler, I deleted some of very small countries like Liechtenstein, but we may, if you take a book, Local Autonomy patterns of local autonomy, you will have information of Liechtenstein as well. And well, you mentioned a very important topic, which might be a topic of a separate lecture, of a tension between decentralization and cohesion of a country. And definitely there is a tension. And I am a fan advocate of decentralization, but of course decentralization is decentralization within the state. So it's not like creating separate countries. And this is, but and if you take individual services or individual dimensions of decentralization, you sooner or later meet a dilemmas. And dilemmas are really dilemmas. It means there is not an easy answer. This is better, this is worse. There are different values which are, and there is a tension between them. For example, decentralization, strong decentralization, means a possibility of a variation of quality of services in different parts of the country. It means a possibility of different access to services. And at the same, well, if you ask, I can bet that if in Armenia, if you ask people in public opinion survey, do you support passing these and these more functions to local government? People would say yes, they should be decentralized. But if you ask them, do you agree that quality of school education might be different depending on where you live in Armenia, they would probably say, no, we don't want this. There is a tension between these two things. Of course, there are equalization systems, there are, well, many different tools, but the tension stays. And it's definitely not to be solved in a short answer for a question in the discussion, or if you take whatever, natural environment, environment protection. Do you think that a decision on creation of a national park should be purely local decision? Probably not, because it's a national heritage. But if you say, okay, it should be done just by local government, central government, without taking into consideration opinion of local community, you are on another extreme and you will criticize this solution as well. So that's, again, there is a tension between these two values. And I don't think the answer on where is the balance between the two is an answer which might be given by experts. It's a political answer. It's a what we agree on. But anyway, you are very right that this is, there is a tension. And I should perhaps explain, moving to this local autonomy index, that our focus was on municipal government only. So we didn't take into consideration upper tiers at all. I know that a few years ago there was a similar study on regional autonomy index in Europe. But we deliberately concentrated on a municipal level only. And the question about Armenia. Well, this is... Well, when I see that there are still local governments having less than 50 residents, I don't believe they might be visible. So in this, if you ask me, even with my very limited knowledge of Armenia, well, maybe I am not an ignorant, but my knowledge of Armenia is very limited. So if you ask me, Do I see a rationale for some amalgamations? Yes, definitely yes. I may agree that small local governments have their beauties. I may agree that positive effects of amalgamation are overestimated and they are sometimes doubtful, but it does not concern a community which has 25 residents, for example. Well, it's not feasible. At the same time, I would like to add that positive, if there are going to be positive effects of amalgamation reform, they are not automatic. I mean, the danger is, well, I always say that the lesson of Georgia reform from 2006 might be a warning for Armenia. In 2006 in Georgia, they replaced about 1,000 local governments by 65. So very massive amalgamation. I see two problems. One is that, in my opinion, but it's more my intuition, they went too far. Some of these 65 are, especially if you go to the mountain areas. If you need to travel 2 days to the center of your local government, and you can do it only from May to October, because otherwise there is snow and you cannot, well, it's too far. But second thing is that the main argument in Georgia was those small local governments, they are very weak, they cannot provide any function, so their role is very limited. So let's do amalgamation reforms, we'll have stronger local governments. And what they have at the moment, they have large local governments which are almost equally weak as they were before. So if you want to have stronger local governments, you need to give them a chance. Size itself is not enough. You need to give them financial capacity, you need to give them functions. And what happened in it happens from time to time that we say, okay, if we have larger local governments, we can give more functions to local governments. But then you implement territorial reform, but you never give them more functions. So this is perhaps a danger which you face, and which is a very real danger.
Thanks. Very much picking up your last point that you brought up. I think as we see this consolidation, you call it here, amalgamation of these local municipalities, communities, the issue of capacity to really deliver on this larger unit is very much at the center. And it's not only capacity, it's also kind of the historical relationships of these communities now have to politically and administratively cooperate with each other, creates all sorts of problems. But it's also an opportunity. It's also an opportunity to really have an intervention where you help these communities build capacity growth, and you have need resources, of course, for that. So I guess my question would be, where was this done right? And where can we learn from? Of course, it's not automatic. Of course, it's not natural that looking at it, some best practice, some success story will have a success here, but at least some guidelines, some package of support that you can expect to have as part of this consolidation amalgamation. I think that would be very helpful with Armenia going forward with this consolidation initiatives. And also thinking long-term about the cultural change that this brings. Community X and community Y living next to each other historically have animosity. But this is also an opportunity to create kind of peace building or coming to terms with this historical grievance or something that then you can transform into a larger set of skills for social change. So where can we look for these lessons learned?
Thank you very much. My name is Gray, Catholic University of Lille. I wanted to capitalize on the last question. So there is a commonly agreed argument that voluntary or unforced amalgamations work better. And there's always the case of the Netherlands that is the commonly agreed on best practice of how you should implement amalgamation. But then in many southern and polyamic continental countries, there is no culture of cooperation. So if you demonstrate the practice of France, where I am student work, equally been working in Armenia for 15 years. So if you don't have the practice of a voluntary amalgamation, you push the country into a forced amalgamation, and you end up with the statement from Morrison about a quick war, and you end up with a disaster that the Danish amalgamation was, with the tragedy of commons example that was throughout the entire amalgamation reform and is also present in Armenia. So if neither of the two works, is there any need to implement amalgamation at all, or is there a recipe, is there a tip for that?
Well, of course, in an ideal world, the voluntary amalgamation is better than forced amalgamation. But voluntary amalgamation is not necessarily a solution. And for two reasons. Well, one is that it might not happen. Second is that sometimes it takes forms which are counterproductive. Ukraine is a very recent and very interesting. I don't want to be taken as a critic of this because it's really interesting. For the last 3 years, Ukraine has been encouraging the voluntary amalgamation of local governments quite successfully. Well, more than half of the country has now created gromadas, the new units which are much larger. And it has been done through a set of strong incentives, financial and functional incentives. Basically, once they amalgamated, they could get more money, new sources of revenues, and they could take most of services which were delivered so far by rayon level, by upper tier. And in most of cases, taking into account number of problems Ukraine has, I would say that in most cases it goes on quite smoothly. But sometimes it produces a very strange results. I will try to draw this on a whiteboard. So, for example, you had a rayon like this, divided into several very small local governments. And most of these local governments has agreed to amalgamate. And, okay, except of this and this. And there are cases like this in Ukraine. So you have a new, huge, relatively big local government, but these two have decided not to join. Okay, so now this big one takes over functions of rayon and finances of rayon. Rayon is not necessary here anymore. But what about these two? Who would deliver services to them? Does it make sense to keep rayon level just to deliver services to two small local governments? So, well, these are the traps which might be traps of not steered amalgamations. And when I was thinking about models to follow, or at least models to study, opposite to what you said, I would still think about Denmark. Well, Netherlands is also an interesting case. In Netherlands, actually, this amalgamation is done through provinces. So it's not a national, in spite it's a unitary country, it's a policy of individual provinces, which might be different. But Denmark, well, I know the critical analysis of results of Danish reform, but still I see a lot of, I had somewhere two slides about Denmark, but I cannot find them at the moment in my laptop. I still see several nice features of Danish reform, which are worth analysis and worth of which are worth considering. One of them was thinking about political consensus right at the beginning. So they've created a commission to work on the concept of territorial reform, which had some experts, but in which major political parties felt represented. So there was, well, okay, you may say it's part of Scandinavian consensual political culture. But there was more or less political consensus of a major political forces over the reform. And the way of, well, I know Morrison calls it a quick war to be won immediately. If you look how immediately was won, it took 4 years, or something like that. So it was carefully prepared, and the political consensus was very much in the center of this preparation. And when I confront this with the recent Albanian reform, which was, in many ways, it was rational in terms of what has been done. But the failure of the reform was a failure of political consensus. It was implemented by the Socialist Party, while the major opposition party, Democratic Party, boycotted final voting and in fact boycotted the idea of the reform itself. So it makes the reform let's do not discuss whose fault it was, whether Socialist Party tried sufficiently enough to discuss with Democratic Party or not. I am not Albanian, I do not have an opinion whose fault it was. But the effect is that the reform is not necessarily sustaining. It may happen that if in the next parliamentary election Democratic Party would win, they may reverse the whole reform. So discussion and political consensus is something very important, and this is something to I think Scandinavians to watch, and that especially Danish. Well, another example, a very nice example of voluntary process of reform is Finland, perhaps even better than Netherlands. So this is another case which I would suggest to study. And just one sentence returning to Armenia. One of the problems I understand you had sometimes with your reform was in some cases total lack of consultations. Well, it's a legal problem because it's a part of European Charter of Local Government which requires consultations. Those consultations, results of consultations are not necessarily binding, so you don't need to follow results, but at least you need to talk to people. You need to listen to them, you need to discuss with them. And my limited knowledge from what I heard tells that in some cases this condition was not met, which is not only a legal problem related to European Charter, but it's also a problem for the legitimacy and sustainability of the reform.
I have a feeling we'll not let Dr. Slimanovic go home today, and time is short, but still we have time for one last question.
Thank you very much for your detailed explanation. You touched briefly on direct versus indirect proportional elections to the council, the pros and cons of this model, and you mentioned some countries that still pursue direct elections to the mayor. I think the dilemma we're facing now is that the government, the proponents of the amalgamation, are trying to push for proportional elections to the council and indirect elections to the mayor. And their main argument is that proportional elections to the council create political competition, and thereby there might be emergence of new political forces, new and revitalize, you know, democratic local governments in such a manner. The opponents of this position assert that the directly elected mayor is responsible and is accountable to his constituency, while in an indirect election end up accountability to the party itself. So what is your experience in observing this country, both in the transitional space and those in the developed order?
Well, you touched at least two topics. One is direct or indirect appointment of mayor, and the second is proportional or majoritarian election of a council. Well, we tried in Poland all of these. In 1990, we had indirect election of mayor. I mean, we elected the council, and the council was appointing an executive board, collective executive board, including mayor. And under this regime, we have complained that mayor was too weak and the position of executive was too much unstable. Council could recall the executive board. So it was harmful for efficiency of policy implementation. In 2002, we introduced direct election, and among arguments which there were in a public discourse at the moment was, we want to stabilize the position of the mayor, we want to make his or her stronger, and we want to, and then if he or she is directly elected, feels directly accountable to voters. Did we succeed? Yes, too much. And now we complain that the position of mayors is too stable, and that there are several mayors who stay for several terms, and that it's too strong and council is powerless. So now we are thinking about reforms which would partially reverse, not totally, because public approval for direct election is too high to return to indirect. And I think that in contemporary world, the personalization of politics is too strong to reverse to this, whether we liked it or not. But we have this limit of terms of office, just maximum 10 years. Well, I think it's good in big cities, but I'm not sure about rural areas where you might not have alternative elites, and where the Putin-Medvedev-like arrangement might very likely happen. So I am not sure if it's really a solution. And we have also some changes of regulation to empower the council to give a larger control. So I am not sure whether it's really... I see arguments for both, and I do not have a very strong opinion. Poland is different from most of other European countries, and I cannot fully explain why it's different, but it's different in a very small role of political parties in local governments. And direct election of mayors contributed to this very much. So we have so many mayors who were elected in 2002 thanks to the support of political parties. But once they were elected, they broke their ties with parties. They said, I'm not going to listen to the head of my party. I have direct legitimacy. People voted for me. And I could give you several examples of mayors of even big cities who were elected as party mayors, but rather than second, third term, they candidated as independent. And it was not a fake that they just were not telling about the links. They brought links with a party, with a political party. And about proportional and majoritarian election, again, in the country, depending what do you want. If you want a stable majority, well, majoritarian system is better. In majoritarian system, we tried both systems in Poland, and it's very clear that in majoritarian system, proportion of councils in which there is a clear majority of one group, of one party or one local group, is much larger than under the proportional system. But also, if you have both majoritarian system and direct election of mayor, we have several difficult cases of cohabitation, as French call it. So, one group successful, well, voters split their votes. Sometimes they vote differently for the mayor and for the council. And you may have opposition to the mayor dominating in the council, and difficult council-mayor relationship, which might be healthy for democracy because control is better, but it creates also problems for effective management of local governments. Like approving budgets becomes a problem. So again, there are pros and cons of different different solutions and in different circumstances may look different.
Okay, well, time is out. I have to express my gratitude to Dr. Svanjevic for making this trip to Armenia, for expressing his interest to meet the academic and expert community and to share some of his great experiences, academic experiences in federal administrative reform in Europe. I realize that some of you might have more questions, and I truly apologize for not giving this opportunity, but I suggest after we finish now formally, you can come down and have a chat with Dr. Svanjevic. With this, I have one pleasant responsibility, which will accomplish today's guest lecture. I'm asked to present the certificate of Dr. Svanjevic on behalf of the Chair of Political Science and International Affairs. This certificate of appreciation is given to guest speaker from the University of Warsaw for delivering seminar on local government reforms in Europe in the 21st century.